This is the third and last video that covers lecture number 26 of APM 504 at Arizona State University. So that's a problem we already solved earlier in the semester using what we call linearity of the expected value. It's the coupon collector's problem, where if you remember, we have coupons that you can buy. When you buy the coupons, you don't know which type you are going to get. We assume that there are n different types, and what we were able to compute was basically the number of different coupons, the total number of coupons you need to buy, like at least the expected number of coupons you need to buy before you get the full collection, meaning before you get all n types. But that was under the condition that each time you buy a coupon, that this coupon is equally likely to be of each of the n types. And if you remember, the solution we find was expected value of n. So here n is defined as number of coupons we need to buy to get all types or the full collection. That was equal to, well, for the first one, clearly, once you buy just one coupon, you get one type. And so that was just one. You need one type. You need to buy one to get one type. I'm going to write this as n over n. It looks weird, but let's do this. You will see after a while. And then for the second type, we saw that you have a probability, basically 1 minus 1 over n to get a new type. And then that becomes 1 minus 2 over n and so on. And for the last one, you only have a probability 1 over n. So eventually, we found this sequence. It's just this n minus 1 plus and so on, n over 2, and then plus n over 1. Okay? So if you remember, we were able to express n as the sum of independent geometric random variables. The first one has parameter 1, the success probability is 1, but the last one corresponds to the number of additional coupons in average you need to buy to get the last type. But then for the last coupon, at each try, you have only a probability 1 over n of success. And so we found this expression that behaves like you can put n in factor, and eventually your 1 plus 1 half plus 1 third up to 1 over n is of the order of log n. So that's what we proved earlier during the semester. That was before the coronavirus, and I was able to do that in class. So right now, what we want to do is something much more sophisticated. We want to try to compute the expected value of n, but assuming that each time you buy a coupon, you are not equally likely to get each type, and we are going to call pi the probability of getting type I. So for instance, you can imagine the situation where you would have some types of coupons that are more valuable and that are more difficult to get, or other coupons that are pretty common, and then you want to put a weight to that, and then again we can compute in this case the expected value of n. So now you see that this one appears in chapter 9, which is weird because we don't see the connection with Poisson processes. In fact, that's a very, very beautiful application of Poisson processes. That's something that happens sometimes in probability theory. That's a very beautiful technique. But also the problem is pretty difficult, and I will not give you this type of problem at an exam, except if at least I would add a bunch of questions before so that you can see how it goes. So basically, the idea is that in this case, you already think that you buy a coupon at step 1, you buy a second coupon at step 2, a third coupon at step 3, and so on. So that looks like a prime in discrete time. Then the trick here is to switch to continuous time, and it turns out that sometimes if you switch to continuous time, things get much easier. And in this case, that's mostly because we are going to be able to use the thinning property. So that's the first prime we see that relies on the thinning property. So first step, which is one hint in the book, you basically assume that we buy the coupons at rate one. So again, this means at the time of a Poisson process with Parmier one, which also means that you basically wait an exponential amount of time with Parmier one to buy the first coupon. Then you are going to wait another exponential amount of time with Parmier one to buy the second coupon and so on. And just using this, we simplify everything. So first step, it's then you call T the time to get the full collection, or let's say all types here again. So it looks like T and N are the same. In fact, they are not exactly the same. If you look at the definition, here it's really number of coupons you need to buy. So that's a discrete random variable. You basically look at an integer, like number of coupons that you buy. So you, it's kind of something that evolves in discrete time. Here at the opposite, you do things in continuous time. You buy at right one, and then you call T the time to get all types. So this random variable becomes a continuous random variable. But it turns out that those two ones are related, and in fact, you can prove that the expected value of T is equal to the expected value of N. So that's what we are going to do. In order to compute the expected value of N, first we prove that expected value of N is equal to expected value of T, and then after we are going to use properties of Poisson processes to get this value. So that's a nice trick. And so the way we do this is, well, first you are going to call, to see the connection between N and T, I'm going to call Ti, or let's say Xt is going to be the process that keeps track of the number of coupons we buy. So Xt is number of coupons bought up to time T. So by definition of Xt, and by the assumption that we buy at right one, that means that Xt is going to jump and increase by one after each time an exponential amount of time with Parmier one, which means that Xt is in fact a Poisson process with Parmier one. I can write like this. It's exactly a Poisson process with Parmier one. Now, if you write Ti, the inter arrival times of this process, so which means the time, like let's say you have I coupons or I minus one coupons, how long you are going to wait before buying the next one? Well, we know also from the theory that those TIs are independent exponential random variable with Parmier one. And then from that you can express, like show the connection between expected value of T and expected value of N. And you get that expected value of T is, we are going to condition on N to find that, okay? That's going to be just the expected value of the conditional expectation of T given N. But you see also that basically T can be expressed as first arrival time plus the second one and so on up to T sub N. So eventually you get that this is expected value of the conditional expectation of T1 plus T2 and so on, Tn given n. And now because in this conditional expectation n is known, you can extract n, and eventually you end up with expected value of n times the common mean, the common expected value of those TI. Those TIs again are exponential with Parmier one, so this is just one, and so eventually you get that this is just the expected value of N. Okay? So you see that if you switch to continuous time, indeed T and N are not equal. In fact, the probability that they are equal is equal to zero because this one is discrete while this one is continuous. but you can prove that the expected value of the true and the variables are equal. So that's what we are going to use. Now I can erase all my proof here in blue, and I'm going to write the first result we were able to find, which is the fact that n and t have the same expected value. So we have that the quantity we are looking for, expected value of n, is equal to expected value of t. Now, how can we find this expected value of t? Well, we can call, let's say, tau I, the time to get type I coupon. Okay, how long it's going to take before we eventually buy type I coupon, and then you see that the expected value of t is just the maximum of all those ones. Okay, so basically, yeah, you look at in continuous time, how long does it take to get type 1, how long does it take to get type 2, and so on. You call those numbers tau I, and it's clear that the first time at which you are going to have, which is time t, in fact, the first time at which you have all types, that's exactly the maximum of the waiting time for each of the types. So you can say that t is in fact the maximum of those random variables tau I. Now, the problem is, how can we find those ones? And it turns out that finding those ones in the discrete time setting is pretty difficult, but in continuous time, that's very easy. And the proof is just a picture, and that's where we use the thinning property. So you have zero here, and then you have, now I'm just drawing my process xt. You remember, xt is basically the time at which you buy the coupons. So that's just a Poisson process with parameter 1, and that's it. So meaning that the time between those crosses and those crosses are the times at which you buy the coupon, and the times in between are independent exponential and variable with parameter 1. Now, by the thinning property, you know that I'm going to switch color. You know that each time you buy one coupon, it's going to be type I with probability pi. So maybe this one was type I, maybe this one is type I again, and so on. So, which means that you can extract from this process. So again, I use a Poisson process and I call it xt. In fact, I draw again a Poisson pond process with parameter 1 to visualize all the story. And so you see that here, to keep track of the times at which you get type I, basically it's like extracting from this set of points some, let's say, right points with probability pi, and that's where you are going to get your time I coupons. But then the theory tells you that, and that's the statement of the thinning property, tells you that if you start with a Poisson process with parameter mu and you extract points independently with probability p, you end up with a Poisson process with parameter mu p, which means that in this case, mu equals 1, the p we are looking at is pi, which means that the time you need to wait before you see your first type I coupon, that's exactly this time tau I. By the theory, by the thinning property, this should be an exponential random variable with parameter mu p, in this case, 1 times pi. So that's what we obtain eventually. We obtain that this one is just the exponential random variable with parameter pi. Now, it turns out that those ti are also independent. And so from this, you can deduce an expression for the expected value of n. So, contrary to the expression we found in the case where coupons are equally likely to be chosen, so that means pi equals 1 over n. Now, in this case, we are not going to get an expression as explicit, but it's still something. And so the way it goes is as follows. You just say from this expression, you can say that expected value of n is equal to, so the expected value of the maximum. And so in general, the expected value of a continuous random variable can be expressed, that's a trick we saw a month or two ago. You can just compute the expected value of this continuous random variable by looking at the integral from 0 to infinity of the probability that this random variable is larger than t dt. So here, I'm looking at the max of the tau I larger than t dt. So the fact that the expected value of x, let's call it x, is equal to indeed the integral from 0 to infinity of the probability that x is larger than t dt is just a consequence of Fubini's theorem that we saw at the very beginning of the semester. I'm not going to comment too much on that. That's a trick we used once, maybe in the discrete case with sums. And then this is easy to compute because we know that tau I is exponential. And so you see that looking at the max larger than t, that's not nice. Maximum larger than t doesn't give you much information about all those ti, but the complement of this event is a nice event. It tells you maximum of the tau I is less than t, which means all of them should be less than t. So we are going to replace this by 1 minus probability of the complement, so that's the integral from 0 to infinity of 1 minus the probability that the maximum of those tau I is less than t dt. And this thing is not very difficult to compute. Again, that means that all the tau I are less than t. And so eventually you end up with integral from 0 to infinity of 1 minus, so here, meaning that they are all less than t, and because they are independent, you end up with a product of probabilities. So you get the product for I equals 1 to n. You have n such random variables. Here I'm using the fact that the max of the tau I less than t is exactly the event that tau 1 is less than t, and tau 2 is less than t, and tau 3 is less than t, and so on. So that's indeed a product of probabilities. And then I need to multiply by the probability that indeed tau I is less than t, and this probability is just 1 minus e to the minus. Deux parameters, remember that tau I is exponential with parameter pi, and so the probability that tau I is less than t is just 1 minus e to the minus deux parameters pi times t. And we need one more parenthesis, n dt, and this concludes the problem. So eventually you see we don't have an expression, like we cannot argue that this thing converges to something like precise, like n log n, like we did before, but the problem is significantly more difficult, and we can still get some pretty explicit expression. And again, you see here the trick is really that, like, it seems that even if conceptually continuous time is more difficult to understand than discrete time, in continuous time you don't have those nasty overlap, and you can treat things in a nicer way. And you see that in this case, for instance, what we use to eventually get the result is this thinning property. So we know that if we buy coupons at rate 1, at the time of a Poisson process with intensity 1, then we can indeed compute explicitly or determine explicitly the random variable that will tell you how long it takes to get type I. which would not be possible in discrete time because of those overlap. Given that you get one type, then you are less likely to get this other type. Here it's not the case because of the thinning property, and you can easily express all those time ti nicely. They are just exponential with Fourier pi, consequence of the thinning property, from which you deduce this nice expression. So now what you can also try to do is, if you assume that the pi are all equal to 1 over n, this expression should simplify somehow, and you should find something that is again of the order of n log n. And I think that's it for this poem and this lecture, number 26. The next ones will be about continuous time Markov chain, and it turns out that continuous time Markov chain are related to these stories of Poisson processes, exponential random variable, and also discrete time Markov chain. So the next chapter we are going to look at, chapter 10 of the book, that's not the last chapter of the book, but that's the last one we are going to cover for this class, is in fact a mixture of chapter 7 and 9. The one about discrete time Markov chain and the one about this stuff, Poisson processes and exponential random variable.